We are in the Tokieda bathroom in Northern California, near San Francisco, on Stanford campus. Something that was discovered between my son, who's just turned four, but he was two at the time, and me, 2 summers ago. We used to go to a swimming pool, and he really liked it. I would, of course, cuddle him and go into the pool, and he was very, very happy about the cold water and warm sun, and so on. And we took a little ball with us, and we played with this. But then the following experiment was suggested by my son. He wanted me to push the ball, which floats in water, into the water, and then release. And of course, it bobs up and then, you know, dances and stays on the surface of the water. And then he said, well, release deeper. And when I release a little deeper, it pops up clear above the water. It actually jumps into the air.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we thought, well, if I go deeper and deeper, it will jump higher and higher. But watch what happens when I release really deep. It just wobbles up to the surface and, you know, stays there. It doesn't clear the surface. So if you think of the height to which it pops as a function of depending on how deep you release, it's not monotonic. It's not that, you know, the shallower the higher or deeper the higher. Actually, there is a maximum around what you might call the sweet spot or sweet interval, if a good distance below the surface, where whoop, it pops rather nicely. There has been some literature on this, I discovered subsequently, and people seem to talk about pop-up and popping, which I have been doing. But I'd like to introduce a new terminology. I think that it should be called porpoising. As in the animal porpoise, because, you know, those sea creatures, porpoises, dolphins, and seals, are able to leap out of the water, right? And of course, these creatures have very good muscles and hydrodynamic shapes and so forth, but it would be rather surprising if they didn't take advantage of this mechanism, where for free, just by starting from a sweet depth, you can leap into the air free of charge, right? Just by that. So it would be a good thing that porpoises are doing, so that's why it should be called porpoising. And besides, then we can ask questions like, what's the purpose of porpoising, and so on and so on. I'd like to make a suggestion as to what's going on, and which, you know, my son more or less said the same thing in his babbling language. And so when you dip very, very shallowly, of course, there isn't really much, you know, buoyancy and there isn't much time or distance over which the buoyancy acts, you know, floating force acts. So, you know, it doesn't go very far. And that's understandable and that's intuitive for everyone else. When you sink them a little deeper, then the buoyancy, as I said, the floating force, has sufficient time and sufficient distance over which it acts. So it pulls it up and then, you know, there is enough momentum where, as it breaches the surface of the water, to go up. So that's, again, believable. You know, details can be calculated by classical hydrodynamics and so on. But the mystery is why, if you give it a really deep release, it doesn't pop up. And I think the answer is already suggested by what you're seeing. When I release from there, do you see? It doesn't go straight up. It actually moves sideways. It oscillates sideways. And it's, you know, wasting a lot of energy and a lot of motion. And when it comes to the surface, that's where it stops. Yeah, so it goes sideways. Yeah, and that wasn't really convincing, but yeah. That was maybe a little more convincing. So I'm going to let the water settle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It kind of has a
sideways motion. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Very nice.
Okay. All right. Okay. So at this stage, I'm going to take up the brown paper. Yeah. So this ping pong ball is moving forward like that. Okay. Now, as it moves forward, it has to get the water around it out of the way. So what's going to happen? For example, here's a little blob of water, and then this water has to get around the ball, so it rolls like that, and then comes off. So the result is that it shares what is called a spinning pattern of water, which is called a vortex. It's just behind like this. And then a little earlier, you are shedding some vortex like that, and vortex like that, and so on and so on. As it goes up, it starts shedding vortices. It's creating some kind of vertical pattern, spinning pattern around it. On this side and on this side, in opposite ways. And of course, the picture is three-dimensional, so it's shedding vortices all around and so forth. Now, this kind of sort of spinning pattern destabilizes the ball. And so when it sheds a vortex like this, it kind of pulls this sideways, and when it sheds the vortex from this side, sideways and so on. And it is, has been noticed that for some range of motion, speed, size, and density of the water, and especially viscosity, this shedding is in alternating patterns. So one side, the other side, one side, the other side. So it starts oscillating. Whereas if you start from too shallow, then this mechanism doesn't have time to kick in, so it just goes straight up. And then that's very, very effective because you come straight up and you pop straight up, straight up. Whereas here, if you start too deep, you go sideways, and then by the time you reach the surface of the water, you don't really get anywhere. So that's what's going on.
Professor, I imagine millions of these are happening per second, though. Why aren't they sort of all cancelling each other out and allowing the bowl to remain straight?
That is a very good question, but the reason is, as I said, for this range of motion, you know, if it's very, very fast or very, very slow, that's a different story. But for this kind of daily motion of that size and magnitude, this shedding, it turns out, happens in alternating fashion. So, you know, there is no cancellation, but because when it's shedding, being shed over here, the previous vortex is already far away, and the previous one before that is even farther, and so forth. So you go one side, the other side, one side, the other side, and that's why it wobbles hither and thither. If everything was happening much, much faster than everything, and then you get something called turbulence, this is a huge mess of vortices that are kind of cloud together and so forth, then, you know, all bets are off and you just get the messy motion.
And Professor, why does this mechanism stop the bowl from leaping high? Is it because it's wasted its energy?
That's right. So it's wasting a lot of energy behind, and we shall come back to that. But also, you know, because it goes sideways, that's, you know, part of the energy that should be used to move upward and being wasted sideways. And so it doesn't really have anything left by the time it reaches the surface. Okay, this is zero above water. Yeah? And it had some strange maximum and then goes down. So the question was, what is this maximum? Well, we understood that, in fact, what was going on is that somewhere here and somewhere here, the motion of the movement of the ball was very different. So here, you just, you know, bobbed up and down. Here, it kind of went hither and thither and wasted its motion sideways, and so it didn't go. But here, it cleared the water very nicely. By the way, another thing that we didn't really emphasize when we saw it is that in this case, because it's kind of going sideways, it also tends to splash quite a lot of water. And that's more wastage, if you like, in the motion. But anyway, so because of this, there's some kind of strange maximum. I would say that here, when there is this separation between this regime and this regime, is about one diameter deep when you release. And here, when there is some loss that starts because of this oscillatory motion, ultimately because of the vortex shedding, as we explained, is maybe 2 or 3 diameters deep. Yeah. So that's more or less the picture. I'd like to show you the vortex patterns that are left behind or in the wake of the moving ball. But in order to see that best, you would like to have a shallower water. So I'm going to let some water out. That's good, that's good. Okay. The vortex pattern that is left behind in the wake of a moving object, or the flow past and then, you know, in the wake that it's formed, can be seen in the bathtub if you have it at a suitable depth. So here, you can move a finger across in your bath, or in this case, let's move a familiar ping-pong ball. When I move it across, do you see at the bottom of the bath, you see some shadows of those black spots? Lots of black spots on this side, and in some kind of vague alternating pattern. It's not so clean, of course, but you can see it, right? And those are the shadows of the vortices that are being left behind. And this pattern, the alternating pattern of vortices that are being shed at all times, and which cause, if you like, some sideways oscillation and so on, and so on, we'll come back to that later, was discovered by a number of people, but it's now known as von Karman vortex street. And this is really a very beautiful pattern that arises behind some fluid motions in the wake. this pattern is used in a rather clever and, in fact, miraculous fashion by swimming creatures such as fish. So have you ever wondered why, not only fish, but, you know, seals and dolphins and porpoises, indeed, that I mentioned before. Have you ever wondered? I mean, you have certainly been to see some seal and so on, and, you know, they don't seem to be doing anything. They just wiggle their body a little bit and whoop, off they go, right? Whereas human champions, the best of the swimmers, have to do so much work and splash all over the place. And then they don't go that fast, do they? I mean, you know, we can all outrun these people on the ground. So how come those creatures, just by wiggling their body, go so fast and so efficiently in terms of energy and everything? That is the mystery that needs to be explained. And this is how it works, to a good approximation. So let's say that water is coming from front to back, or this creature is moving from back to front, like this, like that. And let's say in the first instance that this is a submarine. So it's a rigid body, so no flexibility there. There's no animal mystery there. Well, as I explained, well, in the two-dimensional model, what happens is that on this side, the water has to roll along the body like this. There is something called no-slip boundary condition, which was noticed by Stokes in the 19th century. Anyway, so it rolls and rolls and rolls, and then behind it, it leaves a vortex like that. On the other side, water rolls and rolls like this, so it's rolling in the opposite direction. And then in the back, it leaves a vortex like that. And so on. It keeps shedding vortices, as we say. Okay, so this is the pattern that is left behind of vortices, which we saw some rough representation of in an experiment in the bathtub. Remember, this is completely rigid. Now, what's going on? You can see that this vortex, for example, is kind of swirling, stirring the water around it. So it induces a flow like that around it, which then pushes those things forward, right? Because it's kind of inducing the flow like this. And on the other side, this vortex, for example, is spinning like that and induces a flow, circular flow like that, and it pushes those vortices forward as well. So this row of vortices and this row of vortices are helping each other, and they're pushing each other forward.
Almost back to where they came from.
What they came from, exactly. And that's a forward momentum, yeah, of this vortex train, street. But this creature, or this submarine, then is leaving a forward momentum in the wake. Well, that's, you know, for the momentum that he really wanted to keep for itself to keep move forward, that he has wasted by leaving it in the wake. So that's why it suffers.
But you're saying this is a bad thing.
Because it's all left behind. You know, this submarine wants to keep all the forward momentum to itself, but instead it's giving the forward momentum in the wake to the fluid that it's leaving behind. So, you know, you are ejecting this forward momentum, just if you like, well, I don't want to have any impolite analogy. But anyway, so, you know, it's all wasted. So that's why it suffers, and that's why it feels that, well, short of forward momentum, it feels a sort of backward force, if you like, and that's called a drag. You know, it can't really move forward so easily. That was a rigid submarine, which of course then has to have huge motors and so on in order to keep moving forward, and it has to expend a lot of energy. Now, what does a fish do, or one of those creatures do? It does more or less the same thing, because of course the motion of the fluid is exactly the same. Water keeps rotating like this, rolling on the surface of the fish, or this swimming creature like that is the same. But a swimming creature is flexible, so it flexes its body like that, yeah? And it's the flapping motion of the tail. And by doing so, it guides this vortex on this side and then flicks it and leaves it on this side. And the vortex that started growing as the fluid kept rolling on this side, again, you know, after that, it flexes its tail like that and flick it leaves on this side. So it keeps leaving this kind of vortices on this side and this kind of vortices on this side. Okay, and there, there, and there. It may not be so apparent, but this row used to be over here in the case of submarine, and this row used to be over here in the case of submarine. But what the fish did by flicking its tail and placing the vortex on the other side was to exchange those two rows with respect to submarine. Okay, with what consequence? Well, this vortex, again, you know, induces a circular motion like that. But look, in this case, it's pushing the partner vortices backward. Yeah? And this side is inducing a circular motion, and it's pushing the circular the partner vortices backward. In other words, those two rows of vortices of the vortex street are actually helping each other to push backward. That's backward momentum. Whereas in the case of a submarine, we had a forward momentum that was left behind. Well, this creature then, a fish, is leaving backward momentum in the wake. Well, that's exactly like a jet engine. You see, you are ejecting something behind, which is going that way very fast. By recoil, you go forward. So it gains forward momentum. Yeah, because it's leaving a lot of backward momentum. Well, that helps. And that's how it can go so fast. Because it just exchanged those rows of vortices that it's leaving behind, thanks to a judicious flexibility of deflection of its tail.
This episode was brought to you by Mel Science, creator of these fantastic subscription boxes full of hands-on learning and experiments. Appropriately for today's video, this one's called Artificial Sea. Everything you need's in the box. Instructions are easy to follow, and it's super safe. Now, I'll be honest, I think I mucked up. I may have put a little bit too much copper sulfate in here. But the result was kind of fascinating. These blue-green bulbous things constantly growing and then collapsing. And isn't that what experiments are all about? Learning, investigating, maybe making a few mistakes? Anyway, this is what it should have looked like. Personally, I think a subscription to these would be a great present for the learners in your life. There are so many great boxes and products available. Check it all out on the Mel Science website. And by the way, there's a 60% discount for the first month of any subscription if you use the promo code Numberphile60. The code, the link, all the details are in the video description.
That's verse number two. What's going to happen if I pull the ends of the paper? Well, you know, somebody not observant might say, oh, what's the difference in here, here? Well, probably it doesn't matter. Well, but you remember that version number one ended up having the rubber band hanging from the paper ribbon